anywhere in America, this would be considered a major college athletic facility. In fact, the NCAA might say that this is a premier college athletic setting. The NCAA also tells us that only one out of every 10 American high school athlete, boy or girl, will ever find their way to a college setting like this. And that is a hard reality. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, a program which attempts to address those realities. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this once again tonight is the Inside Corner. We're at Now Serving Cafe on Hillgrove Avenue in LaGrange. This is our second time here. They didn't kick us out last time, so we came back. The topic this evening is one for every amateur baseball coach in the area, from Little League through high school and college, if they're watching, and also for players and moms alike, for that matter, because we're going to discuss certain aspects of amateur baseball that will bring you some insight and give you some perspective about whether or not you have children playing, particularly if your sons and daughters are involved. And I have experts with me tonight. Not Little League coaches, who would be an expert, I'm sure, and not high school coaches, who would be equally knowledgeable. But I have three gentlemen with me tonight who are experts because of their perspective. They are all Major League Baseball scouts, and they see baseball at all levels, amateur and professional, and they work at it all year long. So they brought their perspectives with them about the status of amateur baseball in the Midwest. Is the talent level diminishing? What is the condition of amateur baseball, Little League through college? To my right, Al Otto, 15 years of Major League Scout, the last 14 with the Chicago White Sox, played 3 years of professional baseball himself in the New York Yankees farm system. And next to him, Steve Breen, assistant to the Midwest Scouting Supervisor of the New York Yankees, has been in that capacity for the last 4 years. And next to Steve, to my left, we have Bob Hale of the Chicago Cubs, Bob, by the way, played 11 years of professional baseball, and most interestingly, 7 years in the big leagues, and even more interestingly, was a member of the 1961 New York Yankees. And that's why they're here, for the perspective they've gathered as professional baseball scouts. But what the other irony, I think it is an irony, is that all four of us are former educators. Al is 35 years a teacher at Rolling Meadows High School, and Steve is presently teaching in the Evanston Public School System, adaptive physical education. And believe it or not, the major leaguer amongst us here, Bob Hale, has a PhD in educational administration and retired as a grade school principal in the Deerfield Public Schools. Park Ridge Public Schools. So I find that not only encouraging for myself, a former teacher and coach, but rather an ironic detail that, you know, there is a life after baseball. So there you have it. Now, we can't get away, first of all, Bob, anybody who just heard me say that you played in the 61 Yanks is going to strangle me on the street if I don't ask you something about your experiences there. If you had to pick out one highlight of the 61 season with the Yankees, what might it be?
Well, Terry, as you know, I was a left-handed pinch hitter. The DH was not in vogue then. And I think probably the most exciting time for me was the day that Roger Maris hit his 61st home run. I was able to go in the last half of the game for Moose Skowron, and I got a base hit. And of course, I kept the box score, and it's on my office wall.
I bet it is, yeah.
The day that Maris hit his 61st, and Bob Hale is in there. And I show it to my grandkids and say, see, this is me. Jeez. So that probably was the most interesting part of
it's my 61. It's baseball history, and it's almost, it's part of American history.
given the way that baseball is ingrained in our society.
It makes my Little League box scores saved not really look that good.
I guess so. Puts my trophies in the garbage.
Yeah, Bob, was the hysteria when he hit that home run the same as it's been recently when Bonds has hit home runs and McGuire's hit home runs? Was the ball a big deal at that time?
The ball was a big deal, Al. However, part of the things we're going to talk about tonight, the players at that time did not act like the guys who hit the home runs today. Right. Maris hit the home run, ran around the bases. But I caught his 54th home run in the bullpen. I would like to have been out there when he hit the 61st, but I wasn't. But if you know, remember the story, there was a young man out there. Everyone wanted the ball because they knew it was going to be worth $5,000, wow, the Seattle World's Fair.
$5,000.
And the ball was hit. One guy put his jacket up, and the ball hit on his jacket. Well, this young Italian fella, truck driver, grabbed the ball. And an interesting part of it, when Roger hit his 60th home run, tied the record, we were in Baltimore. And Roger called the young man who got the ball and said, you know, I'd like to buy the ball. And the kid said, well, you'll have to come out to my house tomorrow morning and talk to me. And from what I understand, Roger was going to offer him all expense paid trip to the World Series for him and his wife. Well, when Roger got out to the house, all the big TV trucks were out there.
Oh, man.
And Roger was the kind of guy, he turned around, went back to the hotel and said, keep the ball. This kid came running in with the 61st ball and said, Roger, here's the ball. And Roger said, sell it, get whatever you can for it.
No fool.
So that's the kind of guy Roger Maris was.
Isn't that remarkable? Considering that the McGuire balls and the Bonds balls and the Sosa balls were going for hundreds of thousands. Then they get a million for one or two?
And causing fisticuffs and lawsuits.
Yeah,
and
lawsuits.
Kinds of stuff, you know.
Times
well, it's a little different world.
Times have changed. Talking about players' personalities, again, the viewing audience would find me remiss if I didn't ask each of you to comment a little bit about your clubs and give us some of your opinions about your own home club. So I'm asking you this question. Give me the player on your club or players on your club that you think are complete players that young kids should use as role models.
Good question.
All right. Yeah.
Want me to take this
on
one?
The White Sox, too. Right.
I'll take this
on
one.
On the White Sox.
The home team. We'll go with the White Sox first, the home team, right? There's not just one player that I could speak to because there's so many, really. I'm fortunate in that I can spend a lot of time in Arizona and see spring training, so I'm kind of have an up-close look at this. Mm-hmm. And if you want names, I would say people like Maglio Ordonez. I watch his work ethic, and of course we all know what an outstanding player he is, but how he prepares, it's just amazing. We take for granted maybe and don't really realize the effort that these guys put in. So I would say Ordonez, if we're looking for names. Paul Konerko, our first baseman, same thing. And if we would name a third, I would say Mark Burley. He just tireless worker, is super prepared, and really all three of them.
Yeah, and a bulldog on the mound, boy.
Yes, he is.
Yeah.
And that's not to slight any of the other players because
I understand.
They all work hard. All right. There's a lot of money
out there.
Let's
go to the other side of town.
Okay.
We're now on the north side. Okay, Bob.
Well, Terry, I've been thinking about that as I was sitting here, and there are a number of players, as Al said, it's hard to single one out. And I'm not as fortunate enough to have spent a lot of time with these guys like Al has. People think that we're down at the ballpark watching the Cub games.
Yeah, you're not. You don't have time.
And we're really not there. We're out in the field doing high school or college. But I thought about it, and who I really like as a role model is Mark Pryor. Seems to have a good work ethic. He's an educated person, clean-cut person, and he's someone that I would want my grandson to emulate. But we also have others, Kerry Wood, Clement, the pitchers I'm talking about. As far as the Latinos, Moises Alou. I mean, these guys have all had good solid careers, mm-hmm. and they've had good backgrounds, and they've not gotten into trouble.
I just saw in the paper the other day where Pryor, he's on the disabled list, but it's given him more time to finish his degree, and he's receiving his degree from, is it from USC?
He's graduating, I think.
This month.
And he's out in Arizona, he'll go to the graduation, yeah. and then I think he's going to join.
Remarkable.
That kind of stuff makes you more the role model almost than yeah. for the average person, than the batting average or the earned run average or yeah. that kind of stuff. That's.
And I want to emphasize again the remarkable aspect of your career and the ultimate result, perhaps certainly one of the highlights of your working life, is the fact that after professional baseball you achieved a doctorate's degree in education.
Well, you know, Terry, after I quit,
I mean, who's done that?
I say this tongue in cheek and I laugh yeah. about it. I never worked a day in my life.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to start working then. I wanted to be a coach. So figured I would start back to school, get my degree, did become a coach, got my master's degree, became an athletic director at the junior college level. I always was striving for the top. That's the way I put it. In baseball, I made the top. In education, I made the top. Yeah. The only top I didn't make and tried for was be a superintendent of schools.
Yeah, didn't do it.
I became a principal, and it might have been best for me. Maybe that wouldn't have been a good marriage.
A lot of teachers wouldn't say the superintendent was the top of the heap in education.
But it might not have been a good marriage for me. Maybe I wasn't suited for that kind of a
probably
job.
Probably not.
Because I'm very strong, yeah. and I don't think a board of education maybe doesn't want to hear what I have to say.
No, you're a trench guy.
Even though it might be the right
thing. You were a soldier. You were a soldier. Like you're rolling the Yankees. You were satisfied with that role. I mean, you accepted the role. You were the pinch hitter guy who came off the bench.
I was thrilled.
You accepted that, right?
I was thrilled with it.
Today, your agent would be suing the ball club because you weren't playing
enough.
Not
getting enough at bats.
We were in Baltimore somewhere, and some fan said to me, hey, Baldy, is that your age on your back?
Oh, really?
I said, that's my age on my back, but that Yankees on the front.
Yeah. That's so great. Steve, talking about the Yankees, give me a player off the club right now that kids can use as a role model.
We can muscle in on the home team a little bit. I'm not as fortunate as Al in that Al's retired, and so is Bob, and so is Terry.
That's
I'm
right.
still actually teaching, so yeah. I don't get to see these guys as much. But I think guys like Bernie Williams, Posada, Jeter, guys that have been Yankees for a long time, they play hard, they play hurt, they run balls out, they do all this stuff. Besides putting up numbers and winning championships, they just seem to play the game the right way. And I think the Yankees, for better or for worse, people, you know, whenever you say that's who you scout for on the street, there's always a derogatory comment usually, but they've done it with team type of players, guys that play hard and guys that to play the right way. So I'd say there's no limit.
Let me add something there. Having been in the Yankee clubhouse,
yeah.
if you don't play that way, you're not going to be there.
Yeah.
I mean, the Yankee tradition was such that if you're a loser, they're not going to have you. In fact, they had guys in the minor leagues that they had great years, great numbers, but they weren't the type of person that the Yankees wanted in that clubhouse to be with that team. So the Yankees, I think all 25 of those guys are probably very good citizens because the Yankee tradition is such that they have to live up to that. As far as when you're with the Yankees, it's amazing the kind of family relationship, and that's where baseball has changed. When I played, which is a long time ago, there were 25 players. You got on the bus, you went to the airport, you all got on the plane, you flew to the next city. Your wives and families did not fly with you. Now, they're making so much money. I couldn't afford to take my wife with me. Right. Now, they make so much money, the families go with them. The plane lands, there are 12 limousines. They get on the limousine with their lap computer, and they go to the hotel.
Yeah, no.
Whereas with us, 25 players got on the bus, and we were a family.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of
friends,
guys had
right.
like jobs in the off season. Right. They were part of the community. Well, they were more like regular guys.
We had to work.
Yeah. Well, if I can stick my 2 cents in for the Red Sox, even though I asked the question of you, what little I've been able to observe, the time I spend in Florida and what I get to see on television and what I hear from my bosses, is that Trot Nixon, as a position player, is a great role model.
Guy's got conforming values, works like a demon. He's hurt right now, and he's just chomping at the bit to get back. And then on the mound, Wakefield does an unbelievable amount of work in charity. He's attached to this thing called the Jimmy Fund out of Boston, which spreads money out to the disabled and the homeless. And these are two stellar guys in baseball. All the guys that you just mentioned are the guys that baseball needs more of. We need more of those guys in baseball. But enough about that, because really the topic of this show is amateur baseball. So I want to ask all of you, with the great perspective that you had and years of experience, is baseball attracting the same athlete that came to play in 1960 or 1970? Are we getting the same kind of kid that we got in 1960 or 1970?
Why don't you take that one out?
I think we're getting good kids, but I don't think we're getting as many. I think the numbers are down. As a coach, I can remember at my high school, I began coaching in the early 70s, well, actually late 60s. For instance, our freshman team, when we had tryouts, we'd have over 100 kids come out for the freshman team. And we'd have two and sometimes three levels at the as freshmen. Now, I know there's some schools where the numbers are so down they can't even...
There's some teams, if you come out, you're on the team.
Yeah.
Because other places still get a large number. But, I mean, some places, if you come
so
out...
So they're going someplace else. The
they're going... Yeah. I feel they're going someplace
else. They're not going to other sports.
Are you talking the same... When you say the same kinds of kids, you're talking athletic ability or character or both?
The whole package.
I think you and I are
not going to be interested in a kid if he doesn't have the whole package.
I think you are losing kids to other sports because there's more specialization now, which I'm not a big fan of. When I coached at Stevenson, I was a pitching coach there for 10 years. We were always good when we had multi-sport athletes. If we had the guys that said, I'm going to take the offseason to get ready for baseball, we usually weren't very good. Yeah. But if we had kids that were shooting clutch free throws, they were the goalie on the soccer team, they ran cross country, they were wrestlers, they were football running backs, we were good.
Bob, before you get you put your 2 cents in on this, we're going to have to take a break for a public service announcement. It's a requirement, so please don't get angry. You know, we'll be right here waiting for you when you come back. It'll be about a minute, so come on back. We'll be waiting right here for you.
You know us for our bravery, our technology, and our passion. You know us for our skills, our dedication, and our pride. And now, as we defend freedom around the world, you will know us as everyday heroes. Air Force Reserve, above and beyond.
How do we work out?
And I'm Big Bird.
And we love to make music. Music can help kids learn. Did you know that making music, any music...
Like Twinkle Twinkle?
Right, like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star can help your child with language, reading, and even math.
And it's lots of fun, too.
To find out how children learn and grow with music, visit www.amc-music.org.
And you'll see...
Music works wonders.
Yeah, it sure does.
Sometimes I feel like other girls, but sometimes I don't. I can't write or play sports, or sometimes I can't even ride bikes. It's affected my wrists, my knees, and my ankles. I'm Amanda. I have juvenile arthritis.
Take control and log on to arthritis.org. We can help.
Thank you for coming back once again. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner. And the topic this evening is
the condition of amateur baseball in Midwest America. Are we getting the same athlete, caliber of athlete that we might have been getting in amateur baseball, Little League through college, that we were getting in 1960 or 1970? And I have three truly expert guys here tonight, all of them professional baseball scouts, Al Otto with the White Sox, Steve Breen with the New York Yankees, and Bob Hale with the Chicago Cubs. And Bob, I want your opinion on this.
I've got some thoughts on this. Yeah. I feel that we are losing some baseball players to other sports, and particularly soccer. And I love soccer, and I think it's a viable sport for certain kids. But it seems like soccer, especially in Park Ridge, is a year-round sport. Mm-hmm. When I was a kid, when it snowed, we went inside and played basketball. When it was warm, we played baseball. And when it got a little chilly, we played touch football or football.
Yeah.
And in fact, when I played, you could only play one inflated sport. If you played baseball, you played basketball or football. So I think today they're specializing, like Steve said, with soccer. And I'm against the year-round sport. Although I love it, my grandkids play it. And as a school principal, I thought it was a good sport that I recommended to some mm-hmm. people. I think every kid should have something to feel good about. And being on a team makes you feel good. You get a t-shirt or you're part of a group. When I had a youngster who was not the greatest athlete, and I'm not saying you don't have to be a good athlete for soccer, but for certain levels of soccer, it's a great game.
It's an involvement sport.
If the boy wants to kick it, he can kick it.
Yeah.
If he doesn't want to kick it, he doesn't have to.
Yeah.
In baseball, if the ball's hit to you, you got to catch it.
Yeah.
And if you're up there hitting, you got to hit or you strike out. So there is a failure involved where there isn't at the lower level soccer. As far as the kid, I do feel that they're bigger and stronger because of the conditioning and things that are going on today, discounting steroids. But they are bigger and stronger. The only thing is, I think they're missing out. They don't have the passion that the kids had when we played. I mean, we were playing all day long. And I hate to say when I was a kid, but when I was a kid, that's what the older guy said.
I feel the same way when I was a kid, and I'm a little bit your junior. I'm sure these guys feel the same way. Don't you think basketball is a distraction from baseball?
I think you can be a basketball, baseball player, but I think to play all three...
It's physically impossible nowadays to play three sports.
Well, you said basketball was... Well, it's according to school. If football is the sport,
Different schools or football
gets
schools.
The scheduling in the summer, you have to go to football practice. If that interferes with the baseball game, too bad.
Mm-hmm. I think Terry's got a good point, though, that the seasons have gotten longer, and there's more summer and
true.
More off-season,
now look,
so now you
we
can't
We did a
play,
show
you know?
Last year, and the title of the show was The Diminishing Three-Sport Athlete. And I called four schools, Nazareth, Lyons Township, St. Ignatius, and Fenwick. St. Ignatius had no three-sport athletes, none. And we defined a three-sport athlete as a kid who played all 4 years, same three sports. St. Ignatius had none, Nazareth had two, Lyons Township, a school of over 4,000 kids, had three three-sport athletes. Fenwick had one. They don't exist anymore. A kid can't play three
Tough
sports.
To do that.
The specialization.
Did you guys feel like when you coached that you at least felt like that the best, better athletes that were in the building were out for baseball?
Yeah,
even if they were a sub or a role player or whatever, they came out for baseball.
Yeah, they came out for baseball, but they were double sport guys at the least.
Right.
They were also a star in basketball or football.
Right, that's what I meant. If the guy's a great athlete and he's in your school, did he come out for the team at Rolling Meadows? Yeah,
and we encouraged to play more than one sport. Mm-hmm. I think we might be seeing now where coaches are not encouraging mm-hmm. their kids to play more than one sport. A basketball player has difficulty playing basketball and baseball nowadays. Because there's a fall league, of course they play in the winter, then there's a spring and there's a summer league, and there's competition for the kid. And what I always have said is we're putting the kid in the middle, and that isn't where the young man should be.
Right.
And
kids are having to make the decision to leave the baseball game in the middle to go to the summer basketball game or something like that.
I don't think coaches cooperate with each other anymore. In other words, you might say, well, hey, basketball is going to do this, and you know, and you get together with the guy and work a schedule out.
I don't think they do that anymore.
It's non-existent.
No. Right. They're covetous of the kids. Mm-hmm. They, you know, the basketball guys, my experience as a coach, the basketball guys wanted my baseball guys in the spring. They wanted them to play three-on-three tournaments on spring weekends during the baseball season. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine the converse of that. Me going to the basketball coach saying, I need your guy on Tuesday to pitch the ball game. You can't play your basketball game tonight. That never happened, but they certainly wanted the baseball guys out of there. Mm-hmm. So I guess the consensus here is that we are not getting the same athlete that we got in 1960 or 1970. And one of the reasons is, the major reason is, if we are not getting the same athlete.
I think we're getting good athletes, but we're not getting as many.
We're not getting as many. And the ones we're getting, am I correct me on this, the ones we're getting are not playing enough baseball. Because they're involved. They might be over-involved.
I don't necessarily agree with that. I think that it goes both ways. I think some kids are playing too much baseball. I think some kids play a lot of travel teams and stuff, and they kind of get sick of it.
Excellent.
I mean,
have traveling teams, and there's a gajillion of them out there, and have traveling teams, and you're getting it now, everybody listening. You're getting it now from three guys who don't do anything else but watch baseball every day from about February 28th until the snow comes in early November. Literally, that's all they do. And traveling teams are all over the place. The question now is, have the existence of traveling teams improved the skill levels of amateur baseball players in the Midwest?
I think you don't want to walk the fence, but I think you can actually make a case for both. In the right situation, with the right coaches and the right parental support, kids get a lot better by playing with a certain program.
So you're telling me in a utopian situation the kid gets better.
But then there are other cases where you got six games in a weekend and the kids are tired of playing because they did it last weekend, and you're not getting better under those circumstances. You're playing too much and you're getting worn out and you're getting tired. It's just like in class when you're the principal or the teacher. If the kid's not ready to learn that day, there's only so many tricks you can pull to get him to learn. If he's not prepared to learn something that day, you're fighting a losing battle. And I think sometimes the travel teams, well-intentioned as they may be, overdo it.
Burn the kids out?
Yes.
I don't know if we can generalize and say
every traveling team
is good or every traveling team is bad. I can speak from personal experience. My grandson played traveling team for the last 2 years. I thought it was a disaster. I would rather have had him play in the house league. He would have played every day. He would have built up his confidence. I feel it would have been more beneficial.
Did the traveling team practice?
No. As it was, the traveling team had 14 boys, and the reason for that was it cost so much money.
Yes.
Uniforms, balls, and they had the best. They had Cubs uniforms, Cubs bags, two sets of uniforms.
Yeah.
But anyway, my particular case, in that league, everybody batted. Well, my grandson always batted 14th. Well, he had to hit 1,000 to be successful.
Yeah.
One for one, because he only batted once. So to me, it was 2 years of waste. Plus, the coaches were not that well versed on one, handling boys. My grandson, who's now playing high school baseball, is doing real well because the coach is encouraging him. Hey, you know, you strike out, hang in there.
Was the coach the father of one of the traveling team players?
Yeah, there were three fathers. And strikes out.
Nothing wrong with that, but that can get sticky too.
Strike out, a disgusted look rather than, hey, get him next time.
Yeah.
They didn't have the child psychology courses that we had, how to deal with kids positively. And so that's one team. I'm sure there are other traveling teams who...
Where it works.
Terry, it seems like you've got a little edge to you about the travel team thing.
I do, because it is not enough for the kid to play games. And those traveling teams play a lot of games. Yeah. I mean, that's good. 50 games, 60 games. I know some traveling teams are playing 80 games. The kids are 13 years old. They're headed for burnout. You have to rehearse the game. You have to rehearse the skills. You just can't get thrown in the arena and expect to improve. There will be some improvement in terms of playing maturity, but the skill level doesn't necessarily increase just playing, you have to rehearse the skill.
I agree with that.
And in the traveling setting, I don't know if that's always possible, or if the instruction is present. So that's my axe to grind with it, because in my experience now, 6 years a scout, the game has not improved in skill level. It's diminished in skill level. That's my opinion.
And you're not talking physical talent. You're talking
I'm talking about
skill
refined
level, how to
talent.
Play.
Yes.
Right.
And I refined think talent.
What I see is the instincts of the player nowadays is inferior to what it was a few years back.
Savvy.
Now, why is that?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Playing all those games, you ought to have some savvy,
but
right?
I think they're playing plenty of games, but I think they're not practicing and getting the instruction that's necessary. And I'll throw this in too. I don't think kids are watching baseball and learning from, it's all over the television now. In fact, there's probably too many games on television. You can sit down and watch five games on cable channels and
gets to be pretty mundane after a while,
it
right?
It does, and then I've heard kids say, well, I don't have to watch the game. I can watch SportsCenter at 10 o'clock.
Highlights.
And I can see highlights. Whereas if you sit down, I used to run home from school to watch the Cubs on television.
The last couple innings.
I used to race home to watch it on television.
Yeah.
And you'd learn the little insides of the game. I don't think kids are doing that now, because I have a grandson as well. And I can't get him to sit down and watch a ball game.
Well, you have brought in computer games. I mean, that has taken a lot of time away from, and my grandson's an athlete, but he sits at that thing too much. He should be out shooting baskets or playing catch.
But this is a sign of the times, though.
Well,
where society is going.
You know, Steve, you're right too, Bob. You said we're talking on this traveling thing generally. This is not to say that there isn't a traveling team someplace where there's some good instruction, the kids do practice, and they do improve. I happen to know of one. Where that goes on, right here in LaGrange. And the kids come out of there very competently and go into the high school program and do very, very well. I mean, the high school program won the state championship. So there are traveling teams that do what needs to be done to refine the skills of kids.
I'm not saying that the travel teams are bad, because that's where we've come to. I mean, we've come to this.
They're not a detriment. It's just my impression that they haven't had that much effect.
Well, can I say, it seems like a traveling team does develop five or six boys. The rest of them help pay the freight.
It
costs about $1,000 to play in a traveling team.
Yeah.
And the five or six play every day, and they fill in with these other guys who help pay the freight.
Yeah.
So you really aren't developing 14 kids, you're developing six.
We had a traveling team group on here last year or the year before, did a show on traveling teams. One gentleman's traveling team cost $2,500 a summer for the kid to play. Who do we get there? We get, I hate to say this, but we're getting upper middle class kids. Mm-hmm. It's actually that kind of a setting
could rule somebody out that might like to play.
Well, I think, and you guys have experienced it, when a boy plays on a traveling team and gets all these uniforms, when he gets to the freshman team, he's got the old hand-me-downs from the varsity, and they say, What's this?
Go play with my traveling.
And the parents are saying, you know, we ought to take up a collection and buy some uniforms for these kids. Yeah.
All right, let me ask this question.
They've got everything before they even get
they seem to want it all, too.
And banquets and the whole deal.
Okay, drop the traveling team concept. Let me ask you this. It's kind of related. Which position has diminished in skill level the most over the years? Which position? Are we seeing fewer better catchers, fewer better pitchers, fewer better shortstops, fewer good outfielders? Where have the numbers of good players diminished the most by position at a given position?
Catching, to me. I think it's the hardest one. I think less kids want to play it, mm-hmm. less people are attracted to it, and I think, I don't know that it's not because people aren't teaching it well or you're not getting decent athletes, but I don't see, it's not an appealing position. That's my
I'm going to skirt the question a bit and say a skill that I think is diminished is arm strength. I mean, when we scout and we watch an infield practice and an outfield I just don't see the throwing arms that mm-hmm. we may have seen.
You watch the big league games, no one can throw either. It's not, I mean, yeah. you know, they can't throw.
Surprisingly.
Right. Yeah. Well, it gets back to,
there's no plays at the plate anymore because no one can throw.
We have done that. The Little League says the kid can only pitch 6 innings a week, and he can only pitch 3 innings a game. So how are you going to develop arm strength if you don't throw?
Sure.
I mean, the more you throw, the more you're going to develop arm strength. When I was a kid again, we played every day. We threw every day. It didn't hurt our arm. Nowadays, we're actually training kids and big leaguers. We have a starter who goes 5 innings. We have a middle relief man who goes to 6 and 7. We have a setup man who goes the 8th, and we got a closer who goes the 9th.
Yeah.
Now, we're not training these guys to throw more. And if they throw 100 pitches, oh my goodness, we're ruining their career.
Yeah.
And I think the same thing is happening at the lower levels.
Yeah, well, we're to blame because we're putting guys in. I put a guy in the other day, and I put him in as a strictly out of the pen, I said. Strictly out of the pen, 1 or 2 inning blow guy. Right. So it's my fault.
Well, you left out, that. No, Rob left out the situational lefty, too, when he pitches to one guy. That's the job I want.
But see, that's what I'm saying, but that's the nature of the animal now.
Yeah.
It's not like he's learned to throw a lot of innings. I mean, we've done that. I agree with you.
Yeah.
But the kids aren't throwing enough.
Yeah, I would agree with you, and I agree with you, too. Throwing mechanics, throwing arm strength, throw that in there too if you wish. But throwing mechanics is probably the most neglected aspect of coaching at any level in amateur baseball. I don't see anyone teaching kids how to throw or slide or play the outfield. Those three right there.
I'll throw base running in there. I see some
base running
horrendous, and I think there's instincts, and we had spoke of instincts before.
Yeah.
I think instincts is a big part of base running too. Yeah, I think we're not seeing
savvy. We don't see the same savvy. We have to take another break. It only lasts 1 minute, all right? So this is heating up now. So please come back. We'll be right here waiting for you again.
Hi, I'm Chris Clue, snowboarder, Olympic bronze medalist, and liver recipient. Every day, we make decisions that affect our lives and the lives of others. I'm living proof that the decision to be an organ donor is the right one. Make the decision to be an organ donor and donate life. Make the decision to be an organ donor. Make the decision to donate life.
It doesn't matter who you are, or what you drive, or where you live. You have the power to give someone the greatest gift in the world, life. Make the decision to be an organ donor. Make the decision to donate life.
I build schools.
I battle injustice.
I eradicate landmines.
I feed the hungry.
I shape international policy.
I protect children.
I fight for human rights.
I find homes for refugees.
I dig wells.
I develop economies.
I teach people to read.
I influence the president.
I heal the sick.
I comfort the grieving.
I make the world better.
I make a difference.
I change the world, so can you.
Athletic competition is all about potential. The opportunity to look inside yourself, to challenge yourself, to be better than you ever dreamed imaginable. Junior achievement is also about dreams and the potential to make those dreams come true. JA's free enterprise education programs help kids say, "I can," when everything around them says, "You can't." Junior achievement. Let their potential be your inspiration.
Thanks for coming back. Again, my name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner. And tonight we're at Now Serving Cafe and Catering in LaGrange on Hillgrove Avenue, right across from Stone Avenue Station. And we are discussing the status of amateur baseball in Midwest America. By the way, if you have any opinions that differ from ours, and I'm sure you do because we're very opinionated, you can say something about it. You can email us at theinsidecorner@hotmail.com. That's the inside corner
at hotmail.com. Thank you. Okay. We've been through the traveling team controversy, and once again, I'm sure there's a traveling team that does it right. But generally speaking, are the parents of today's amateur baseball players realistic about their kids' abilities? What are you encountering in terms of parental reaction to their kids' experiences? Are you seeing parents who are realistic about their kids' abilities? The kids that maybe you're interested in, put into the draft, or to, as top scouts do many times, recommend kids to colleges. The parents that you are encountering, are they realistic about their kids' abilities?
I don't think they're unrealistic. I think sometimes they're just inexperienced. They haven't seen, let's say kids in high school and he's thinking about playing in college. I think a lot of the parents haven't seen a junior college game, a Division II game, a Division I game. They aren't quite sure where they fit. So I don't think they're necessarily...
So you're running in more of the naive type?
Kind of. And not in a bad... I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean, you got your regular job. Mm-hmm. You're not out watching baseball games all the time, and you don't have that basis of comparison. So I think everybody hopes their son or daughter is really good in the sport that they play, but they maybe don't really have anything to compare it to.
Well, you know, example I use, and you can't blame a parent for having high expectations for the kid and think a lot of their kid. I mean, I think every parent should do that. But when a parent asks me about professional baseball, I say, well, we draft 40 kids in the country. Now, is your boy the best in the state? Because if he isn't, he's not for us.
Yeah.
And they kind of grasp that, and it is difficult to play professional baseball. And I always use this example too. My son played baseball, little guy, in high school. He wanted to be a big leaguer, but nobody asked him. This is the only job where we ask you.
Yes, you. Yeah.
Want to be a doctor? Be a now he's a lawyer, making more money than I made.
Yeah, right.
I mean. So,
and then you ever made in pro ball.
But, but again, this is a unique vocation as far as professional baseball is concerned.
I think that's a good approach to a parent. But when they come on and think their kids are the best player in the area, that's a good perspective.
Well, I've heard Bob say that line before, too, that you know, it's the only job where they ask you to play. Yeah. If nobody asks you, you don't get to play. There's no other way to get in.
There was a nice family in Park Ridge. In fact, the school I was a principal at, their younger boy went to my school. And the father was a great father. And the kid was a 80, 82 mile an hour left-hander at Main South. And I was standing back there one day working the radar gun, and father said, what's he throwing? I said, 80, 82. Oh, come on. He throws 87, 88. So I handed him the gun. You know, I mean, so, you know, we all have high expectations. And so I didn't fault the man, but I just wanted to prove to him that.
Yeah, well, it kind of puts it in perspective. There are 30 teams drafting 50 kids. Each team's going to draft 50, right? 50 rounds.
Right.
Now, some teams don't draft 50. Some quit 42, 45, but nonetheless, there's 50 opportunities with each club. That's 1,500 players nationally. It's a good question. Do you think your kid is amongst the top 1,500 players in the United States of America, Canada, and Puerto Rico?
And the Dominican Republic.
Yeah, and don't forget them too. Yeah, because they can play a little bit.
Well, that's my point. I don't think who's got that basis of comparison. You know, I mean, if you're the parent,
right.
You don't really know. You hope.
Right.
You know, people tell you your kid's good. He wins a lot of games. You know that kind of thing.
You know what else? And I think Al will agree. I think the greatest motivator for a high school kid, elementary school kid, my grandson has his gloves in his back pocket like Chipper.
Yeah.
I mean, he wants to be Chipper Jones. He wants to be a big league player. Every kid wants to be a big league player.
Right.
I mean, and where do you buy that kind of motivation? As a coach, I was always amazed at that. And when a kid got drafted, I was thrilled. Whereas some coaches resented the fact that they were losing a shortstop or losing a pitcher. Hey, I'll get somebody else. Every one of these kids want to play ball and be a professional player.
Okay, you're at a ball game, scouting. Amateur game, of course. You're at an amateur baseball game, maybe it's the high school level, let's say.
When does your evaluation, at what point in time do you begin your evaluation of a player?
Well, I'll take that. If I know who I'm scouting, you know.
Yeah, you know who it is.
You know,
someone threw you the name.
Right.
You went out there, you spot him. At what point in time do you begin to evaluate him?
First of all, we try to get there when they get there, if possible, so we can see what they're doing the moment they come off, if it's a bus or...
See that? Did you hear that, everybody? Did you hear that? The evaluation begins before the practicing, the warm-up, and the ball game.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
when they get off the bus,
as soon as you can see them.
As soon as you can see them.
As soon as he appears.
Because you're now watching all his actions.
Body language.
Yeah.
Interaction with teammates.
How he conducts himself, how he interacts, and how he prepares himself. And so it begins then and there. And oftentimes the player doesn't realize that.
Right.
So we're watching him from that moment. Yeah. And then I was just at a game yesterday, and it was interesting. We wanted to see how the young man would react after being taken out of the game. He was a pitcher. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to see if he would go back to the dugout. He didn't have a good day, how he was going to react to that situation. Because the other team was riding mm-hmm. him, and I didn't know when he got back to the dugout if he was going to let the glove go and the hat go and go into a tirade. He conducted himself very well. But all of that goes down on your evaluation. So,
what were you saying about the evaluation begins when they get off the bus?
Yeah, and you can almost pick the kid out from the physique.
Yeah.
But what I find interesting is there was a player a couple years ago, and somebody asked me about him, and I said, somebody said, can he throw? I said, I don't know. Why not? Well, he never has thrown for me in the infield. Well, can he run? I said, I don't know. You know, why not? Well, he never runs. The only person that I ever came across who trained their kid to put on a show for a scout was Hundley. Todd Hundley, the catcher from Fremd High School.
Yeah.
It was Randy Hundley's son. I mean, if he threw the ball back to the pitcher,
it was max effort.
I mean, in an infield, every throw he made for a purpose. And if kids can be taught that, scouts can do a better job.
And college coaches.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
There are times when I'm looking at a shortstop, and I'll have to say to him, would you, when you're throwing the ball across the field, go over in a hole and throw the ball? Because I like
and
to
air
see
it out, yeah.
Because you really can't tell. So. You actually, from the bus to the end, do they carry equipment out there? Right. What kind of kid are they? Are they
all those telltale
all stuff?
There's so many players for us to see that we only may see that youngster one time. So we need to see what kind of arm strength he has. We need to see how he runs. If it's a pop up to the infield, run it out so we can get a time on you. But
it's the old one chance to make a first impression. I mean, if the White Sox are going to filter it through your eyes and you come one day on a 30-degree Tuesday in March, that's your shot with the White Sox. I mean, in terms
that's
of
it.
If you don't pass the name on to the next guy
above
please,
you. So please, run. Throw.
Run them out.
Make effort.
Make an effort.
All right, a question along the same lines. Let's say you didn't have a name. You're clueless. You're driving down the road coming from a ball game you were supposed to scout. You see another game and you stop. By the way, this is where Mickey Mantle was signed in Commerce, Oklahoma. The scout that signed Mantle was at another ball game and he was going home and he saw a game in the middle of nowhere. I'll just stop and check it out. That's how the Commerce Comet was discovered. Teammate of Bob's. You're at a game, you don't know the name.
I think
you don't know anybody. How do you begin your evaluation when you don't know a name on that field?
Maybe it's not the right way to do it, but I look at the 3, 4, 5 hitters. I mean, your better hitters are going to be there.
Okay.
Then I might look at the shortstop if I'm interested,
mm-hmm.
Or the catcher. You know, does he throw well? And also you look at the future.
Yeah.
Are there any juniors on there playing with the varsity?
Yeah.
Batting in that 3, 4, 5 spot.
Yeah, that's telltale.
So those are some of the things I look at.
What do you do?
Same thing. I usually look at the middle of the order, leadoff man, and the 3, 4, 5 hitters usually, and then the premium defensive positions, catcher, shortstop, center fielder.
Yeah. What's your trick?
Also, I would do that. I would also, if I can get one of the coaches aside, you know, I would just say I just came by here today. I saw a game. Maybe I was rained out someplace else, and I noticed you were playing. So I'm stopping off here. I introduce myself. I'm with the Chicago White Sox. And is there any player on your ball club that you would recommend that I really bear down on and take a good look at? And I would also ask, maybe, are there any juniors, you know, for future? And I might even be standing along the fence, and I may, if there's a kid standing there or a parent or a fan, you know, I may engage in some conversation. And, you know, you, as a scout, you use all those avenues. So
yeah. I did that once.
I think we all do that.
Bad experience?
I think we all do
pretty
that.
Pretty embarrassing.
However, you know, and I asked the coaches, who should I look at?
Right.
However, every coach has a player.
Absolutely.
And there's 500 high schools, and again, we're looking for 40 or 50. And so I listen to them, and I watch, and, you know, sometimes they're right, most of the times they're wrong. Mm-hmm. Not that they're wrong. That person is the best player they have, but he's not the best player in the state.
Sure.
So we're looking at two different things.
Yeah, recommendations from the other team's coach is always good.
Yes.
Other team's guy says you're good.
Yes.
That's some credibility there.
A little bit more objective.
Like Bob said, your own coach. I loved all my players when I coached. I would try to say they were as good as I thought they could be. But if the other team's coach, two or three guys in your league say you're pretty good, it starts to carry some weight.
Yeah. Or umpires.
Yeah, umpires.
Umpires say, hey, you see so-and-so pitch? Threw a pretty good game.
Yeah.
So I talked to them a little bit.
I mean, I committed the biggest faux pas in the history of scouting.
What was that word?
It's a fox pox. I'm out. I saw a game that I was supposed to see, and then I run into another game along the way. I stop because I didn't want to fight the rush hour traffic. So I stop, and I'm watching the game. And I know nothing about anybody out there. And there's a guy standing there, younger dad, at least I thought. And I asked the younger dad, I said, are you familiar with this team? And the guy, yeah, a little bit. He says, a little bit. I saw him once before. I said, who's the player out here? He said, well, kid at short, you know, it's pretty good. I think he's all right. I'm interested. So, really, I watched him a little bit. I said, yeah, I guess you're right. The kid can pick it, can he? He's got a near average arm. I said, this is all right. I said, by the way, my name is Terry Sullivan. I'm with the Boston Red Sox. He says,
I'm the father.
He says, I'm Larry Hatchett. I'm with the Atlanta Braves.
Another scout.
Was he lying?
No, he wasn't lying. He was a cross-checker in town watching the skills.
He wasn't a smart
scout. I had no knowledge of it all. I felt like an idiot. I wasn't very scientific, was I? In any event.
And we've all had stories like that, believe me.
Okay, if you're I don't have any grandchildren yet. Al, do you have grandchildren?
I have.
Are they playing ball?
Yes.
And Steve, you're far
My
too
daughter's
young.
Five.
Okay. I don't have any grandchildren yet.
Kindergarten
so,
next year.
Maybe Bob has the best answer, or Al has the best answer for this over Steve and I. If you had a son, you have a grandson and a grandson, and they were entering into their first experience with organized community baseball, what would be your first piece of advice to them?
Go ahead, Al. That's a good question. I've had this. I have a 14-year-old and a 10-year-old.
Yeah.
Kind of what we've been talking about. Be a good listener.
Yeah.
Just kind of grasp any and everything that you can, and work hard and hustle. You know, just you're only out there for 2 hours, maybe 4 at bats. You tell me you can't run all out to first base on an infield pop up or whatever you do.
One thing I'm going to try to do with my daughter, she's 5, so I guess she'll try a sport here sooner or later when she gets around to it, is try to ask, did you have fun today more than did you win?
Yeah.
As much as
good
I possibly
point.
Can.
Good point.
I
mean, Bob, what's your piece of advice?
You know, I look at it differently. Right now I've got a 6-year-old starting, or second year, and my son coaches, which I'm happy about. He's a great kid and a good coach and a nice person. And he's not out there yelling and screaming at the kids. He's making it fun for them. And in fact, last year he played T-ball, which to me is a great sport. I mean, they hit the ball, they run the bases. You can't teach them a whole lot because baseball is a very difficult game
as far as
fielder's choice, tagging up and all this stuff. But this year, my son had the opportunity to put him into the little sluggers, which they hit pitching. Well, my son said, he's not ready for that. So he realistically kept the boy back to play where he belonged.
Yeah.
And I think too many parents want to push their
push
kids
the guy up.
And in fact, even play, hey, my kid's 9, but he's as good as 10. Let him play. No.
Yeah, not necessarily.
You know, the progression should be there. And like you say, number one, have fun.
Have
fun.
Speaking of having
this
fun.
This is having, I had fun. Being amongst guys I respect and that I have learned from, all of you, as we have our discussions on the fields, wherever we run into each other.
And
Bob,
likewise.
I appreciate that.
Hey, enjoy
I thank you being here. You
I
come a long
it.
Way tonight. Steve, you came even farther tonight. And Al came.
I enjoyed it. I really did.
And I'll tell you, Terry, the food was excellent.
Yeah.
We have to say thanks to the...
Thanks to Paul Link.
Yeah.
Now serving.
Now serving.
And my thank you to John Steers on camera and Phil Satala on camera. My floor manager, Mike Kevorkian, line producer, Tom Sklarski, my director, who's my main man and helps me out so much, Mike May, station supervisor, Bob Foskett, and Dolly, I'll be right home, okay? Thanks, everybody. I'll see you again some other time. Yeah, right.